Good morning, friends. What would you do if you were hungry? His name was Cornelius. He was talking to Kenan Heiss, who was a journalist in Chicago doing some research on poverty, and he told him about the first time he'd ever been dumpster diving. That is what it sounds like, crawling into a dumpster trying to find something of value in the midst of others' garbage. Cornelius said, "I did it because I was hungry. I was proud. I didn't want anyone to see me doing it. I went through dumpsters behind apartment buildings in Chicago. In the first block, I didn't find anything, but in the next one, I discovered a large pizza only half eaten. I took it. I went over to a friend's house who heated it up so everyone there had some. I never told them where I got it from." Would things have been different for Cornelius if he had a promise of food in his future? If Cornelius knew the next morning he would be welcome to a free, all-you-can-eat buffet within walking distance, do you think he would have eaten that pizza from the dumpster? What about us? I think I've told you this story before, but it's been a long time, so I've probably forgotten some of it, and I'm guessing that I'll make up those parts in a different way than I did the last time I told you. But one of my college roommates and I thought we were going to die in the Grand Canyon. We took off Easter break. We drove straight there to backpack through the canyon, rim to rim. We'd mapped out the trails, and more importantly, we'd mapped out our water spots. So we had those iodine tablets to purify water that we got out of the various streams. It made it taste disgusting, but it wouldn't upset our stomachs, and this way it kept us from having to haul too much water in our backpacks. The last stream on the second to last day was dry when we got to it. We thought we'd missed it, so we started walking around. We walked backwards, we walked forward some, we walked off the trails, which you're not supposed to do, and nothing. We even started walking towards the river, which was 2,000 feet below where we were. No water to be found anywhere except a small muddy puddle in the shadow of a giant rock formation. We decided it was better to pass on that. So we walked as far as we could that night, and we just pulled our sleeping bags out. We didn't want to set anything up. We wanted to be nimble and ready to go the next morning. And we decided whoever woke up first, at whatever time in the night it was, we'd wake the other one up, pack up, and start walking out while it was still cool to try to make it up the 2,000 feet that we needed to go to get to the rim and to get to water. We knew there was a parking lot there with several water spigots that came out of the ground so people who are day hiking could fill up their water bottles. We knew that water was waiting on us. We just had to get there. So we pressed the spring water out of our last two cans of tuna and drank that in the wee hours of the morning and hit the trail. On the way up, we were both dizzy. We had a hard time staying on the trail, and by the end, neither one of us could even focus very well on our feet, much less anything farther away than that. We probably passed 200 people that day. Never once asked any of them for water. Why? Well, because we were young and dumb and embarrassed, and we knew there was water waiting for us at the top of the canyon. When we got to the spigot, it was as if we'd discovered diamonds or some buried treasure. We were both so happy and relieved. We felt this sense of accomplishment. Now, on the drive back to Waco, we were reviewing the trip and our newly discovered ruggedness. We both decided it wasn't the smartest thing we'd ever done, that really all we had to do was ask somebody for a drink. But there was something about knowing that the relief was waiting for us that kept us going. And I wonder about this passage in Isaiah that is our Old Testament reading for this morning. Isaiah paints this vivid picture of a bountiful banquet boasting of the finest foods and wine, and it's all free. Well, rather than free, it says we get to buy it without any money. I guess that helps our pride a little bit, doesn't it? We get to buy the food and wine. That gives us some agency in the scenario. It helps us to feel like we're a part of the setting of the meal. I like that this vision is looking out for our dignity, but our dignity is probably what gets a lot of us in trouble in the first place. Who knows? The fact is, Isaiah invites us all to come and to enjoy this feast, to buy our food and our wine without any money. I like to think of this setup like the baseball park in Farmington, New Mexico, where I spent many summers watching my brother and others play baseball in the Connie Mack World Series. One summer, my cousin Seth was there, and he made a friend. They must have been 6 or 7 years old. Seth makes friends everywhere he goes. He has an invitational spirit, and he always finds a way to make you feel at ease. And this was true of him even when he was a little kid. So Seth and this new friend are playing together when they decide they're hungry for a snack. Seth comes up and asks my grandparents if they can go get a snack. My poppy reaches into his wallet, hands Seth some money. I volunteered to go with them, telling them it's not because you're too little to go by yourselves. They totally were. But I said it's because I might want something too. Now, on the way to the concession stand, Seth asks his little friend, what's he going to get? And his friend says, why, I don't have any money, and my mom already told me not to ask for any. Seth, without hesitation, said, oh, don't worry. I've got money, and if it's not enough, my papa has all the dollars we need. It was a beautiful moment I will never forget. What if we were looking into the future, to this bodacious banquet where we get to buy the finest food and the best wine with the confidence of Seth, that our God has all the dollars we need? The prophet asks us why we spend our money on that which is not bread, and why we labor for things that do not satisfy. Great questions. I guess I spend money on things which aren't very filling because I keep thinking they're going to make me feel better about myself and about life. Quarantine life has been purging for us as a family in a wonderful way. We've taken the time to go through some boxes and to clean out some closets. Okay, that's the royal we. The truth is, Carmen has done all of that with the help of Alex and Sam. I've just been the guy who hauls all these things away in my truck. They did all the real work. But it's amazing how clarifying a global pandemic can be, isn't it? I mean, we think about the things we've chased after or the things that we knew we really needed, and then we find them a few years later covered in dust, having been unused for a long time and holding no joy whatsoever. So out they go. Why do I spend my money on things that aren't bread, things that don't fill my soul? Well, I know sometimes I get caught up in the competition of it, right? I think that I need something because someone else has it, or they have something like it, and that makes me think that I want it as well. I hate confessing that. It feels small and gross, but it's true, and I don't think I'm the only one. You know, the whole advertising industry is built on convincing us to buy things that very often will not fill our souls or make our lives in any way more delicious. Why do we work for things that don't satisfy? Again, great question. I don't think work in and of itself is always satisfying. It's certainly not all of it. Otherwise, we wouldn't call it work, right? We would say we're going to play. Now, we know people who absolutely describe what they do as going to play rather than going to work. How do they do it? I think they frame the job in the context of its greater meaning. Educators see past worksheets and angry parent emails to the expansion of minds and the changing of the world. they see how insights gained in the classroom and in the relationship between student and teacher open minds to the world and open people to change our world for good. See, if it's just about surviving another car line or another in-service meeting or another committee meeting on the Committee on Standards, then it's a job. It's work. And it's not very satisfying. But when it gets framed in the context of educating students, well, it can be extremely satisfying. Mike Rowe, who is an opera singer and the host of the television series Dirty Jobs, discovered so many people along the way who had these really disgusting jobs that they found to be terribly satisfying. He would interview and would go to work with someone who had to power wash the giant sewage pipes underneath a large city and unclog the clogs that happened. Now, that person didn't see his life's work as being covered in sewage, though it literally was. He saw it as a service to his community and to his family. The guy would talk about this job, this work that had to be done, and he realized, you know, not everyone can do this. But he knew that he could. And, as he said, it puts food on my family's table and shoes on their feet. He did a job that most of us would consider unsatisfying, but he found great satisfaction in doing it because there were greater things at work in his work. When I was living with my grandparents in New Mexico, I spent several days crawling in the crawl spaces underneath houses that we'd just finished building, cleaning up the trash that the other construction workers had left down there while they were building the house. I had to slide on my belly to squeeze into the places where I had to collect the trash, and I did this job for several days in a row, so much so that it would wear holes in the front of my shirt while I was doing it. One night, I was particularly quiet at dinner, and afterwards, Poppy invited me out on the back porch to sit and watch the sunset. He could tell that I was ashamed of what I was doing, and that I felt like an utter failure in life. He used his stern voice to tell me, "Hey, there is no shame in honest work. Regardless of what it is, you find the honor in doing it right, and you don't let anyone take that from you, because it's in here." The prophet Isaiah wants to make sure that we're working for things that will be satisfying. My poppy taught me that sometimes the satisfaction is something you have to bring to the job, or something you have to see in what the job does for the world and for your family. I've read about various theories about reopening and how some people think that, you know, it's really helpful to have a date towards which we can all, or upon which we can all hang our hope. Let's just wait until January of next year. We'll have a vaccine. We'll all get back to normal. And I get that because it feels nice to think that this discomfort, this interruption, this hunger won't last forever. Now, I have no idea what's going to happen in January of next year, but I think what the prophet Isaiah wants us to know about the end of all years is that there's a banquet waiting for us. God's banquet, where everything will be made right and all things will indeed be made well. We will all be together, and the things we eat and the time we share will finally put an end to every deep hunger pang we have ever had in this world. We will be filled with love. We will be filled with forgiveness and grace. We will be filled with peace, filled with joy, filled with God's presence. knowing what the end of the story holds for us is intended to change the way that we live on our way to get there, right? We don't have to fill our lives and our bellies with things that we know won't satisfy, because we know a day is coming when we will be filled for all eternity. Our current hungers point us to God's bountiful table. Knowing the end of the story allows us to make sacrifices and choices in the middle of the story that we might not have the courage to make if we thought that this was all there was to the story. The assurance of victory allows grace in temporary defeat. It frees us to be kind in the face of rage. It frees us to be loving towards our enemies. It frees us to fight for others even when we know they won't fight for us. It frees us to give sacrificially to anyone in need. It frees us to live the lives the gospel calls us to live, following the example of Christ and taking up our cross daily. So often selfishness which is antithetical to the gospel. So often it's just a problem of vision. We're too nearsighted to remember that we won't be left on our own through eternity. God has all the dollars we need. And that should free us to use our own dollars to love our neighbors in ways that bring the banquet of eternity another step closer to our lives, to invite yet another sister and brother to their seat at the table of God's love, to find the courage to sit more deeply in the chair that has been prepared for us. Friends, a great day is coming when we will feast with God and with one another. So let us let that hope guide and keep our minds and our hearts as we share our bread today. Amen. We sent out a survey by email to you on Wednesday and then again this weekend, and I just want to implore you verbally to fill that out. It's going to give us helpful information as the Administrative Council and the staff try to make decisions about timing on reopening things and how to stage our reopening for whenever that becomes appropriate. So I hope you'll fill that out. The air conditioner is working, but I forgot my jacket. I think it's lying on the back of the couch, which was on my way out of the door, but I grabbed coffee, water, my phone in my backpack and my keys and forgot my jacket. So my apologies. And I don't know if you noticed, but I turned it around. These are different bookshelves behind me than the ones you're used to. So, anyway, just to give you something else to look at while you listen to the sermon. Oh, my goodness. My sisters and brothers, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the face of the risen Christ smile and shine upon you. And may the Holy Spirit bring you peace until we are together again. Amen.